nature of higher education. I want to talk about it as an inherent core principle of learning. An access principle, as I called it in an earlier book, but something that actually is bigger than access in terms of sponsorship, in terms of use, in terms of accreditation, and in terms of the autonomy of the scholar. Now, I noted that the Mi'kmaq tribute that was given at the beginning of my talk is an important aspect. I too want to recognize that we're on the traditional territories of the Mi'kmaq, and I want to bring that in because it's part of the question of property. Part of the point that was made, and I wish I could remember it for a minute. Laura. Part of Laura's point, it's a thing we try to, yeah. Part of Laura's point that I thought was helpful wasn't just to acknowledge that we're on the traditional territories of the Mi'kmaq people, but that the treaties that have been signed recognize certain rights and privileges around the ownership and property of the land. And this plays a very important part for me in terms of John Locke's theory of property, which is where I want to conclude this project, or this talk, but also my project of the book. But first, I want to set up the stage for open access. I want to explain that, in fact, Open Access Week is done. That I may not be the last speaker on open access, but in some ways we have won the battle. For the last 20 years, we have been, some of us, have been advocating for open access. And I think we've passed the tipping point for open access. Now, I had the pleasure this morning of meeting a skeptic, the Associate Dean for Research in Social Sciences and Humanities, who thought we were still in a prisoner's dilemma. I respect that. But for many of us, the situation is now a matter of having passed the halfway point. And we're not technically there. I would estimate, but a graduate student and now assistant professor at Simon Fraser University, Juan Pablo Alperin, is part of a team that has estimated where 45% of the literature is now freely available to the public and scholars everywhere in the world. 45% of the last few years of literature, probably 5 years, 45% of the literature, no matter where it's published, whether it's in Nature, Science, the Journal of Medieval English, 45% of it is generally available. What percent of that is illegally available in rogue copies? What percent of it is available in green open access or in final drafts with every single mistake I have ever made available online to you? What percentage of it is in open access journals is actually quite small, maybe 20%. Excuse me, percent of it is in open access journals. 15% of it, maybe up to 20, but 15% is in this green final draft. So I am delighted that your doctor, your family physician, has a 55 to 45% chance of finding the latest research article, actually less for the latest because there's an embargo of 12 months on the biomedical literature according to CIHR and the NIH in the United States, that's the National Institutes of Health, Canadian Institutes of Health Research in Canada. But the chances that your physician is able to find research, recent research, perhaps not in the last 12 months, has gone up considerably. But I don't think adequately. The idea of spinning a wheel to find out if you are the lucky winner of today's article concerning the diseases or symptoms that you now have seems to me vastly inadequate, and yet we've crossed a tipping point. Why I say that is because of the support from the federal government, from the major philanthropies, from the Gates to the Mellon Foundation. There are major journals in every field now that are open access. There are faculty members who know what open access is, which was the most difficult challenge of all. And all of the major publishers, all of the major publishers are moving in this direction. So the problem today, in this last of the open access talks you'll ever have to go to, the problem today is not whether there will be open access or why there will be open access. The question is how, in what form will there be open access? Who will own, as it were, control that access when it's open? And so the questions today are more about the academic ownership, to go back to this earlier question and preview what I want to talk about in terms of John Locke and the theory of property. The question in terms of ownership is still onerous in the sense that the majority of the literature is owned by the publishers. And there are five major publishers that own perhaps 60 to 70% of that literature. And that ownership will go to open access, but it will go on those publishers' terms, not on our terms. And I want to go back to a historical example to point out to you the struggle between commerce and the commons that is at the very origin of the concept of copyright. I want to convince you that copyright today may not seem to be our friend.
Oops, I'm falling apart here. Excuse me. Maybe I don't hate these notes as much as I think I do. This could happen to you one time. My theory is that everything will happen to you once, so I don't have to worry about that again.
Alright, as I was saying, the ownership of this property is now in the hands of these major publishers. This is Elsevier, Springer, Nature, Wiley, Blackwell, Taylor and Francis, and Sage. And the terms under which we have access to this knowledge is going to go open, but at the cost, and this element of intellectual property ownership is of great concern, because there are no limits right now in intellectual property law on how much is charged for an article processing charge, how much a subscription costs. The publishers, Elsevier, just two quick examples. Elsevier took Sci-Hub to court over the last year and a half. Sci-Hub is that pirate repository of maybe 60 million articles, all freely available through the deep web in a server from somewhere in Russia, in Moscow. Do we know this story of Sci-Hub? We've got some familiarity? Look it up, Sci-Hyphenated Hub. It's been buried because the New York courts have ruled against it, and it is now, as it were, sunk deep into the deep web, but it's still discoverable. People are using it every day. About 1 million articles a week are downloaded from Sci-Hub. Some people say it's easier to use than going to their library. The distribution of users is all around the world. One of the major spots is roughly 20 miles from Stanford University. That is what they're not providing. Sci-Hub has provided download information, but not accurate information as to who is downloading. They've kind of clustered it around ISPs. And California, in the area where I live and work, is one of the major centers for downloading this free software, pre-research. Elsevier took Sci-Hub to court. It started ostensibly by Alexandra Dokin, who is a graduate student and now a young woman who's on her own in Moscow somewhere, probably next door to Edward Snowden. And she is set this up in a way that makes it very easy to download the information. Elsevier took her to court and won a $12 million suit against her. She didn't appear in court. She sent a letter to the judge saying that she thought this was the right thing to do. People need this information. They have a right to the access to this information. And she knows that because Timothy Gowers held a boycott of Elsevier. John Willinsky wrote a book saying this is the right thing to do. Now, I don't know about you. I've never been named in a $12 million lawsuit before. And I am the only party in the United States available to the courts in a way that Timothy Gowers not, in a way that Alexander is not. But they haven't come after me, so I shouldn't make a big deal with it. But I was surprised. I think it's my most impactful citation ever. What it means is that Elsevier owns this property. Elsevier will go to court and will ascribe a $150,000 price tag on each piece of research that it publishes. And the courts will recognize that under intellectual property law. I find this deeply troubling. And I want to talk about how historically we have faced this issue before, three centuries earlier. You're going into your 200th anniversary, congratulations. But we have an intellectual property law that is three centuries old. And I want to consider that aspect. The other thing about Elsevier to consider is that it is buying up infrastructure, that it has purchased a group called the Social Science Research Network, which is a repository for articles, and it has purchased B Press, which provides a publishing platform and a repository that many libraries are using as a digital repository. So it's moving into the infrastructure. And I'm not terribly concerned with that part, except that the ownership of our work is something that we need to defend and protect, not object to, not take Elsevier to court over, but just to understand the importance of that. And this is what I want to address. What I've done is try to create a history of intellectual property before there was intellectual property. What I've done is to say, or to ask myself, where in the world did this question, or this assumption, where in the world did this assumption come from that research should be free? Where did we get this idea? No one's saying that Alice Munro's short stories should be free. No one's saying that Neil Young's songs should be free. But research and scholarship, we think, should be free. Now, the answers are things like, well, taxpayers are paying for it through the grants, and this is a public institution. And even my private institution, where I'm now at, is tax exempt because of its public good. So maybe that's why research and scholarship should be free. Because it's a public good already in terms of its economy. Maybe it should be free because we do it in the name of the public. I'm a professor of education. Every study I've ever done in the field of education has been to benefit teachers and students and parents and communities. And then you can't look at it, teachers, parents, students, and communities, because it's locked up in a university library, unless you can pay for parking and come into that library and have a look at it. That just seems wrong to me. So what I decided to do was to try to get to the bottom of this, not to say because taxpayers pay for it, but to say, what is it about learning that sets up this expectation that it should be freely available to everyone? What is it about the nature of learning? Could it somehow be not just that it was paid for in advance and sponsored? Could it be something about the nature of learning that is different? That it gets its value from being shared? And that, in fact, is true. That, in fact, is a philosophy of knowledge, an epistemology. The epistemology of knowledge is that the more eyeballs that see it, well, one epistemology, one less than postmodern epistemology, one non-relativist epistemology, is that unless people can examine the knowledge, it has no claim to be knowledge. You cannot say to someone, my God, I have just learned this amazing thing, but I can't tell you about it. It is so brilliant, I can't share it with you. Now, we've had people kind of assume that at certain points. Newton was quite retentive and very reluctant to share. But when he did, he realized that it made all the difference, that the quality of the knowledge was not only established by virtue of everyone being able to check it, to criticize it, to ask more questions, to force him to defend his ideas, but that it gave rise to much more knowledge, that it was generative, in a way that went well beyond his wildest expectations. So this quality of knowledge is an important aspect. And what I set out to do was to establish historically where this concept began. And what I want to do is just take you very briefly through that, and then end up with John Locke. So the Latin West begins in the late antiquity and the early medieval period, the Middle Ages, in a time when education was at a low point, when the public libraries of Rome had been destroyed, when the learning and scholarship of that culture, nowhere near as great as Greek, but still a huge accomplishment, was in ruins. There were the monasteries. The monasteries became the preservation of learning in the medieval period. St. Mary's, we were just talking about one of the manuscripts from one of the nunneries that St. Mary's College has, is on exhibit now in the Nova Scotia the provincial gallery. But what distinguished them, although they do get extinguished by Henry VIII, we'll come to that perhaps, what distinguished them was their approach to property. This is the first principle for me. But what also distinguished them is they were essentially, in the first instance, anti-intellectual. The monasteries are a paradox of learning. They were not given to studying. The goal of a monastery was not to be learned. That was the sin of pride. That was hubris. Anyone who presumed to know was making a presumption in the face of God. And the goal of the monastery was to look humbly into the face of God. And so the monasteries that began in the 3rd and 4th century, in late antiquity and then the beginning of the Middle Ages, were weird places for learning. They had two things. One was a sense that learning was a dangerous thing, a source of blasphemy, something that the Romans cultivated. St. Augustine fled it. St. Benedict fled it. That is the schools of Rome, and lived in monasteries. But what Benedict did is he established the rule, the Benedictine rule, the rule that dominated Europe. And when he did that, he inadvertently created a place for learning. Very briefly, he did the following things in his rule. Now, of course, did he actually author the rule? We get into all those kinds of debates. It's a little difficult to authenticate these things. But Benedict's rule, certainly there is a rule, the Benedictine rule. First of all, no private property. And he even uses the example in the rule of the pen and the book. No, that belonged to the monastery. Everything you owned, you gave to the monastery. So everything had to be shared. Secondly, you were able to take a book for a year and study it. And the books could be distributed evenly on Lent, the period of Lent. And everyone would have a book to read. You would spend your time working in the fields and you would spend your time reading up to 4 hours a day. This was Benedict's big mistake. Depending on the light, the season. And you would go to Mass and you would pray. Benedict's goal was to have prayer the whole of the monk's life. But what he forgot, what he didn't realize, is if you ask people to read scripture for 4 hours a day, questions arise in their minds. They begin to notice contradictions in scripture. They begin to ask themselves questions of interpretation. They begin to make marks in the margins, like question marks, exclamation marks, only they weren't quite like that. And that what he did was create the ideal conditions for study. You work in the fields till you're exhausted, then you come in and you sit before the books for hours. You do not talk to anybody. You do not take your phone out of your pocket. You simply sit and think about the text. And out of that arose a spirit of learning that had nothing to do with ownership or authorship, had everything to do with interpretation, making sense out of the text. And the little notes that you made in the margin, what is this about? What did his daughters do with the father? All of these questions that you asked yourself in the margins, somebody else would answer. And then somebody else would challenge that answer. And out of that arose a spirit of gloss and commentary. So we had these initial conditions of learning in monasticism. We had a sharing of the property. We had sponsorship, in which the monasteries were all bequeathed land, much as the land for Dalhousie has been bequeathed by the province. We had sponsorship for the learning that could afford people to work only half a day and spend the other half of the day in study. We had a network of monasteries that were all Benedictine, although not all of them were Benedictine. taking, but the majority were through Europe. And so the books could be distributed because nobody owned them, and they were copied. And Benedict made no provision for that copying, no provision for the writing of books, no provision for that kind of work. But you cannot have the books circulate. You cannot have people reading 4 hours a day without the sense of commentary and question and inquiry and research and study. In fact, the Venerable Bede in the north of England was the first to say, this is about the 6th or 7th century, that I don't learn for myself, I learn for the benefit of others. There's no pride in my learning unless it helps. In fact, there's no pride in my learning. But there's no learning unless I can see it in the eyes of others. Which seems like a lovely principle for any teacher in the room. That the only value in your learning can be judged or is open to judgment in terms of the eyes of others. Just as I'm watching to see. Good. That I'm getting some connection here in terms of the eyes of others. And so this spirit of learning had all of these qualities. It had access to the text. It had the autonomy of, oh, I can talk about the autonomy of the monasteries. The monasteries had a remarkable academic freedom. They would appeal to the Pope against the local bishop, because apparently the local bishops were something of a busybody, were something of intrusive. They were jealous of the riches of the monasteries, because all the great gifts went to the monasteries. They were jealous of their libraries and illuminated manuscripts. And the Pope exempted the monasteries from any local responsibilities, and they had that autonomy. They were dependent on their learning in order to get further gifts and bequeathals. Now, some of these gifts were large lots of land and mills and streams, and other gifts were loaves of bread and bits of cloth from local people. And what impressed them after a while was the quality of learning. What impressed them was the production of books. What impressed them was the way in which their reverence, their regularity, was reflected in their production of learning. And this aspect, then, of access and autonomy, not credit, I'll get to the credit part, but the sponsorship and the use. The value of the work was in its use, and the right to use these works. It was limited in the way that there was very little Aristotle and Plato. They were pagans, but it was available. So these essential principles of access and sponsorship, of autonomy and of use and accreditation eventually. In fact, what happens with accreditation, the idea of giving credit to the author, doesn't happen as a result of any author. Because if Bede had stood up and said, well, in fact, Bede did. I forgot about this. Bede used to list his books in the back, just like Penguin does. He would conclude with a slight CV to say you might also be interested in. And then he would put bead.ca or something like that so that people could find the works. So even, I forgot about this, even Bede had started this notion of recognition. But what really made credit work was the idea of the author as a point of interpretation. What really made authorship and accreditation part of an intellectual property was the idea that if you want to make sense of St. Jerome or St. Augustine, you needed to know what work Augustine and Jerome wrote. Jerome's letters to his sponsors are a famous point of theological interpretation, and those had to be collected and authenticated. And so Jerome never made any fancy claims for himself as a great translator, great theologian, but everyone who followed felt the importance of identifying and giving credit in order to help interpret, in order to settle that Jerome must have meant this in his 15th letter, because look what he wrote in his 11th letter. So the idea that we would talk about authorship and credit as a matter of understanding is what distinguishes us as scholars. And that the intellectual properties of learning are something that we invest in works, not something that the author claims. And this idea that these intellectual properties are something that we developed before there was intellectual property. Intellectual property is a term, comes up in the late 18th century. But my claim is that the learned were using, had a working definition of intellectual property since the early medieval period. It was a series of principles of rights and credits. And those rights and credits, as I've been saying, are about having access to the text, giving credit to the author in order to interpret it, to ensure there's sufficient sponsorship to undertake the learning. And that sponsorship had to come with autonomy and had to enable use. Now, there are lots of counterexamples and contradictions, and the monastery's got way too rich, and Henry VIII, just all that stuff, I don't want to get into that. I want to respect your time and jump quickly to John Locke and the beginning of intellectual property. And that is to take us to the 17th century. Locke is famous for two treatises, a book called The Two Treatises, that he developed, he wrote, well, it's a mystery even when he wrote it, but he published it in 1690, so this is the period we're going to be concerned with for a few moments. 1690, and the first Intellectual Property Act was 1710. That's nice to me. 20 years. 1690 to 1710. Locke is dead, weakens my argument a little bit in 1704. That whole posthumous lobbying thing, I don't know, it's not probably going to hold water. But what Locke did in 1690, he publishes a theory of property that had devastating effects here in this country, that is part of the dispossession of First Nations and other indigenous peoples, because he said that property, the right of property by natural law, is a matter of labor, of cultivation, is his big example. And James Tully, one of the great Locke scholars at UVic right now, was a Locke scholar who realized that that theory of property, that cultivation exercises a claim on the land, that the land is given to everyone in common in the beginning, and then, through the exercise of labor, you have a right to that land. That was used by many of the colonists in the dispossession of Aboriginal peoples. And James Tully is a remarkable scholar who switched from being a Locke scholar to being an Indigenous rights scholar. And has testified before royal commissions and works with Taiaki Alfred, a Mohawk who was part of a political science program at UVic, in terms of indigenous governance, to begin to address the inadequacy of Locke's concepts and the inadequacies of applying Locke as it was applied in the 18th and 19th century here in the United States. But where I want to come in on Locke is his lobbying on behalf of, on behalf of learning in the 1690s. So let me take you back to the 1690s. What happens in the 1690s is there's already copyright, only authors have nothing to do copyright in the 17th century. That's always confusing, 1690s. The 1690s are the 17th century. In the 1690s, there had been, for a century, a book licensing act by which the king traded off with the printers and booksellers a deal. I, the king said, will give you a monopoly on every book, perpetual monopoly. Whole slew, yes, all of the law for you, children's literature for you, poetry for you, and you can print it forever, perpetually. The classics for you. In return, the king said, you need to censor. Every book needs to be licensed. I want no sedition, no libelous works against the crown or the church of England, of which I am the head as king. This is fun. And did the printers buy that exchange? No, because they're very principled. They said, we don't want a perpetual monopoly on whole swaths of literature, because we will not engage in any squelching of the freedom of the press. You're smiling. Few people are smiling because that's nonsense. They said, where do we sign? 1695, when it came up again for renewal, the Book Licensing Act, after they had cut the head off of Charles I, after they had Oliver Cromwell had made a mess of democracy, after the king had been restored, Charles II, they kept that law. But in 1695, they said, wait a second. It's making books too expensive. Locke said it's making it impossible to be a scholar. They won't allow imported books. The person who owns Cicero won't allow a new edition of Cicero. The law books cannot have commentaries because the person who owns the law books will not allow them to be published unless that person approves them and is ready to publish them. And Locke said that this is contrary to the nature of learning to have licensing in this way. And he wasn't the only one. Milton spoke about it against licensing. Only Milton ended up a licenser, as it were, for Cromwell during that period. But at any rate, Daniel Defoe spoke out against it. They talked about it as a discouragement of learning to have licensing of the press. So there's a freedom of the press issue, and there's an access to learning issue. And Locke spelled it out and lobbied. In fact, he didn't publish these works. He worked with another member of Parliament. He worked with a member of Parliament named Clark to lobby as a scholar activist. And he failed in 1995. He succeeded in putting an end to book licensing, but he failed to have his reforms put into place. One more was a book deposit policy. He wanted, and there already was a book deposit policy, a book deposit policy. There already was one that Bodley, Thomas Bodley, had arranged in 1610. I'd love to tell you the story of the Bodleian Library, which Bodley insisted on being a public library. It was always referred to University of Oxford. The colleges had private libraries. The University of Oxford Library was the public library. Only when Bodley gave his money to support it and rebuild it and gave his lumber and negotiated for manuscripts to be donated, he said it has to be open. And to this day, each of you can go to the Bodleian Library and pay £5, but they'll give you a waiver on the £5 if you are in difficult straits, because you have a right to the public library of Oxford. And in that policy, what he organized was a book deposit. One copy of every book printed had to be deposited in the Bodleian Library. They actually ended up calling it, when it was opened, it was called the Bodleian Library, not after he had died. Well, maybe that's very close to his death, period. I should check that. Quick, somebody, good for checking. Okay, thanks. This idea that the book deposit is an important principle that we hold in Canada, the National Library, that is all over the world. Locke insisted that it wasn't being fulfilled properly, but that one copy of every book should be placed into the library. Think about that for a minute. What that meant was the library was apart from the economy. That scholars had to have access in order to do scholarship, and so one copy should be placed in the public library for everybody, and then everybody else, every other bookseller can sell, the printers can print, but one copy. Never worked out very well. Estimates are about 20% of the books ended up there, but it was a start. There are hilarious stories about the Oxford University Library being overrun by books that were donated. They had to sell off their doubles, like a folio of Shakespeare. All of Jane Austen had to be sold off to make room for all the books that kept coming in. They regretted that because they had to buy them back many years later for many million pounds. At any rate, all of these measures argued for. What happened in 1710, after Locke died, there had been 20 years of unlicensed publishing. You probably can't imagine what happened in those 20 years of unlicensed publishing after 100 years of licensed publishing. Was there any untoward literature being printed? Was there anything salacious circulating? Was there anything slanderous available on the street? Yes, you could not go down the street. You could not make it through Oxford Circle. You could not cross the street. people selling and hawking slanderous, libelous, and salacious materials. Papers would be printed, and the next day, the pirated copy would be available. In fact, it was no longer easy to tell which was the pirate and which was the original if you missed that opening day. Presses, and remember, these are all being set by hand. These were not being photocopied at Kinko's. So out of that, everyone agreed this was a little too chaotic and that there was a need for some kind of control. The printers were particularly, the Stationers' Company, which still exists to this day, the Union of Printers were very upset and had been petitioning. In fact, 12 different bills they had put forward unsuccessfully until they hit upon a new title. The 12th bill that they put forward said, what about an act for the encouragement of learning? The 11th previous bill said, an act to make printers richer than they've ever been before were unsuccessful. They changed their tune. They hired a PR firm and said, that thing about being richer than you've ever been before, that's not going well. 11 times, failed. Let's try a new tact. Let's think about Locke and Defoe, Daniel Defoe, and Milton. And let's say an act for the encouragement of learning, and my God, did it stick. An act for the encouragement of learning was the first proposal for the regulation of printing that vested the authority in the author. An act for the encouragement of learning was the beginning of copyright, recognizing the author's rights for the first time. Because the previous agreement had no authors in it. It had printers and booksellers, the king, and the church. That was the agreement for book licensing. So the very beginning of copyright had no other intention than an act for the encouragement of learning. In order to encourage learning, we're going to vest the authority in the author for 14 years, renewable once, for 28 years. We're also going to insist that all of the university libraries receive one copy, of which there were 9 at the time, one copy of each book printed. The rector of the university, or the provost, as we might think of it, had the power to roll back prices. This is my favorite. Unfortunately, they succeeded in throwing it out after a while. The provost had the right to roll back any prices that he felt were excessive in terms of Springer charging $136 for a book this thick, as some of the librarians in this room should recognize, and perhaps it's not up since the last time. There was also a right for an author, before a book was reprinted, to regain control of that book. He may have sold it to a printer, and that was fine, and that was legitimate. But in order for a new edition to come out, Locke had insisted, and the Statute of Anne 1710, which is what we're talking about, upheld the right of authors to have some say in that next edition, because every learned author wants to improve their work when it comes out and correct every single mistake that they're now apprehensive about, given my very feeling of a book coming out in a few months in terms of that. And so an act for the encouragement of learning is the beginning, and it was filled with protections for learning. And those protections for learning created a separate category for works that were considered to be learned. It didn't define them. It assumed that everyone knew what a learned work was. It ended the perpetual monopolies of the printers, but it allowed the printers to be the representative of authors. It allowed the printers to print, to hold monopolies for limited periods of 14 and then 28 years if the author was still alive and in a position to renew it. Now, when the argument comes down to it, the major beneficiaries of the Statute of Anne in 1710 were the printers and booksellers. They could put an end, they didn't put an end. Ireland wasn't included in the bill, and Ireland produced thousands of pirated works. But they got control of the market. They reestablished themselves. They began to buy the rights of authors. They began to offer authors royalties. They began to engage in a practice that did succeed in creating a very successful publishing industry in England. And at the same time, rights of learning were protected to a certain degree. Many of the books that ended up at Oxford had no pictures. All of the illustrations had been omitted. Oh, sorry. Many of the books that went to Oxford were the worthless ones, the crime stories, and the ones that had no meaning in terms of, I shouldn't say worthless, the ones that had less meaning for the learned, where the expensive books didn't quite make it. The ability of rectors and provosts to turn back the crisis was removed in about 1735. They lost that privilege. The publishers never stopped lobbying to advance their interests. And over the years, we have seen their interests advance. Now, Elsevier owns the intellectual property of the work we give them for 70 years. Not only for 70 years, 70 years after the death of the youngest co-author on the article, please include your graduate students. Elsevier sends a note. How come you're not publishing with undergraduates? Elsevier sends you a note. Did you want to mention or include your children in this article? Because the law says 70 years after the death of the youngest author, it controls that intellectual property. The book deposit is still law. One copy goes to the National Library here in Canada. One copy goes to Congress in the United States. The UK does a little better in terms of distributing the books, but it's certainly not enough to keep the libraries well stocked. And so there has been an erosion of learning's place in copyright law. And that the original balance of commercial rights and scholarly rights has been not lost, but diminished. We still have fair use, or fair dealing. I should remember what side of the border I'm standing on. Fair use in the United States, fair dealing in Canada. And fair dealing will protect your individual students from making copies. But York University just lost a lawsuit on whether education is being protected at writ large. And that will be appealed, of course, but it's not clear what the outcome of that will be. The Supreme Court actually in Canada has been quite favorable towards fair dealings in educational purposes. But it's still an open question. And so the future of open access, what I want you to see, is not simply a digital question, not simply an internet question, but is endemic to the nature of learning, is one of the intellectual properties of learning. And that those intellectual properties, through John Locke, who contributed in devastating ways to the nature of property in this country, in this continent, other places, managed to include a space for learning in intellectual property law. And so our two gifts as a community, as an academic community, is the very concept of intellectual property. And you know that much intellectual property today has no intellectual value per se. Oh, you don't know that. Sorry, maybe I shouldn't have said that. I didn't mean to dispel any beliefs. Of course, all the intellectual property in your household does have a really good intellectual value. But we want to hold that what's intellectual about this property, in terms of an access right, in terms of a use right, in terms of a claim on sponsorship, in terms of autonomy, and in terms of accreditation that isn't involved in getting rich, but accreditation in terms of making meaning. All of that is the intellectual properties that we're about in this academic community. And we gave the world that concept, I argue. And we created a separate category that is being lost sight of. Not all intellectual property is the same. And what I'm arguing is that going forward, when we think about open access, we want to think about these larger properties. Are they being protected? At what point are we losing the sponsorship element when that proportion of our research grants has to go to pay for article processing charges? What point are we losing that autonomy when Elsevier can take to court those who are trying desperately to share their research and knowledge? They have issued takedown notices to those of you, anyone using ResearchGate? Any ResearchGate users here? Yeah. So ResearchGate is facing takedown notices from Elsevier because the people there are just too darn adamant about sharing their work. And that apparently is a crime under current intellectual property law. So the takeaway message of all of this is get thee to a nunnery. No, that's not the takeaway message from this. It is that the open access question is vital, that the open access question has tipped in terms of our expectations, that we need to teach this generation of students, all 18,000 of them were walking along the quad here at noon, very beautifully on display. Thank you for doing that for me, putting them all out there, so I could get the full sense of the entire student body at Dow. Those students need to be educated in an expectation that they have a right to this knowledge, that everything the university does is a public good and should be publicly available. And if they're not being educated on how to find and use, access and use, and accredit and appreciate the sponsorship and understand the autonomy and its value, then we're doing a disservice to those 18,000 students, because they're going to graduate into a world that is not going to have 45 to 50%, but maybe 62.3%. I don't want to be overly optimistic in terms of open access's success. That last 20% is going to be very difficult to get. And so we need to think about that as one thing. How do we educate for a world which is open? And the second thing we need to think about is how do we ensure intellectual property law has a balance of interests in mind in terms of its original intention between commercial and the commons of learning. In the current law today, where I think there's been something of a loss for that. So 2 points. Think about the students graduating into a world of expected rights of knowledge. In the country in which I'm working, this has taken on paramount importance in terms of the quality of knowledge that is currently available. And the second point, think about access as a right that is endemic to the nature of